Asking you to solve our domestic discussions. I am asking you to leave a light on so that we can find our way home. Steps to heaven.
Out, we must ensure that climate change is a feminist issue. We must make sure that the experiences of women and girls across the world, so often disproportionately impacted by climate change, are understood as we devise the solutions.
The Lord President, white. The Lord Justice Clerk, white. Every High Court judge, white, white. The head of the Law Society, white. The head of the Faculty of Advocates, white. Every President, Governor.
And I'm very pleased to be joined this afternoon by Professor Meryl Kenny, Grace McCabe, and Daniela Onuwenye, MSYP. So Professor Meryl Kenny is a Professor of Gender and Politics at the University of Edinburgh and a member of the Scottish Parliament's Gender Sensitive Advisory Committee. She's published widely in the areas of gender and political parties, political representation, Scottish and British politics, and institutional change. Grace McCabe is a member of the Young Women's Movement. She's been a member of the Young Women's Movement Advisory Collective for 2 years and loves the fact it offers a space to have conversations with like-minded young women and want to build a better Scotland. Grace believes that young women are experts in their own lives and deserve to be represented in every place that decisions are being made which affect them. And Daniela Onuwenye, MSYP, has been a member of the Scottish Youth Parliament for Paisley since 2022 and has been heavily involved with her local youth charity prior to the by-election that she won. She's currently a trustee for SYP's all-female board and is going to study law with Spanish. So please do get them in and we'll make sure that we get as many of them as possible asked. However, I'm going to start by asking our panellists to contribute to a few questions, and I've grouped three of them for us to start with. So the first one is, what does politics mean to you and what has your experience been so far? What do you think the key barriers are to young women standing for election, and what could political parties do to support young women to become candidates?
And in terms of my experience with politics, it's definitely a space that I want to break into when I'm older. And I'm saying when I'm older because I feel like I'm currently not able to. Mm-hmm. I think that young women like myself have this deep fear of being seen as being silly. Mm-hmm. Like our experience doesn't matter. Anytime a young person is elected to Parliament, all that's ever commented online is they don't have enough experience. What kind of life experience have we got? If you think about people my age, I'm 21, any 21-year-old has a huge breadth of life experience, but especially people my age, you know, our education was impacted mm-hmm. by COVID. We're growing up in the cost of living crisis. We're probably experiencing financial pressures that we never would have experienced before. And I do believe that you can only be what you can see. Mm-hmm. I'm definitely in favour of gender and age quotas because it's so difficult to drag a seat to the table yourself. Mm-hmm. Someone has to hold space for you, and that's why I love the Young Women's Movement, because I've always been taken seriously and everything I've ever said has been, you know, listened to and highly regarded. That's what I think has to happen with political parties, is we do need to hold space for young women, and we need to understand that our experience is so, so valuable. We can't have people making decisions when they haven't walked in our shoes. I think the average age of a parliamentarian, regardless of gender, is 50. Mm-hmm. So my mum's in her 50s and she's an incredibly intelligent woman, but she hasn't lived my life and she can't make decisions for me.
Politics to me goes beyond the connotations of having like to go out and vote and stuff like that. I think the way politics is in our society, it is ingrained in every little aspect of our lives. It just goes beyond of what we think. So for me personally, I'm a member of the Scottish Youth Parliament. So although we are an apolitical institution, that doesn't stop us from helping and essentially carrying out jobs that quote-unquote politicians would do. Examples are that is Scotland's being the first nation to provide free period products for which anyone that needs it. And those are the things that the way politics affects me and my experience personally. Within SYP as an organisation, I've been part of the movement, which is an anti-racist organisation, or like a little working group, I'd say, which aims to kind of make SYP an anti-racist place, provide a safe place for young ethnic minorities to share their experiences and whatnot. And that has evolved into this this year, where we, as a group, we carried out essentially trainings for young MSYPs and the staff, and also the support workers, because we think it's important being anti-racist in this day and age. And that's me personally. Now, a key barrier for young women in politics for me is visibility. But visibility, the problem with visibility is due to those said key barriers. I do understand that being in a place, sometimes you're not always able to see yourself. And I do acknowledge that fact. But that, and it is difficult to be like the first person to do things. But I also believe seeing somebody there, seeing yourself represented, is imperative to see young women in such spaces. And I don't think we see that many that often. And I think that is a very big barrier that we have at the moment. And for political parties to support us young women, I'd say having like visible policies to show that there are key policies there to support them, or to support us, I should say. Making sure that we made it into a place, but are we supported in that place, or are we just there to just like tick off a diversity quota? But yeah,
so that. So about the ways people act informally in those spaces, and the kind of informal ways of doing things, and the cultures, and so on. And those are sometimes harder to shift, though formal rules can help shift them. And I think some of the research on young women in politics shows how their kind of competence and legitimacy is questioned to a greater degree. You know, that they're often kind of mistaken for secretaries or assistants in spaces. The kind of scrutiny that Grace talked about in terms of media scrutiny, of dress, of speech, of those kinds of things. I remember a quote in a kind of Swedish study where young women were saying, well, I started wearing glasses because I looked more serious, you know, kind of in those spaces. Names forgotten, you know, those kinds of daily kind of microaggressions and experiences of everyday sexism, as well as the kind of violence against women in politics, which affects all groups, but maybe particularly acute, particularly around generational issues and engagement with social media and those kinds of things as well.
Well, if you wouldn't want to be an MSP in this universe, can you see yourself affecting change and being involved in politics in another way? And how do you think we can better get that across to young women and young women from different parts of Scotland, different ethnicities and all those sorts of things as well, as to how we can really get people in there? Because if you can't see yourself in politics, then as an MSP, that makes me quite sad for a start, and we need to do better. But how do we get that out there? How could we convince you that affecting change is still something that can and should be done?
Probably things like policy making and stuff like that. Like during the recent election, I was that friend. I was telling people, go out and vote. Have you registered to vote? Like, are you sure you're like, show me you're registered. Like, I was approved, but like, I couldn't vote myself because I'm not even a British national. But I digress. But yeah, like things like that. Like, you don't have to be like, I guess, the one on the podium or on the pedestal. Like, being the one like encouraging people, being the one telling them, like, you have a voice, like, because I'd say most of my friends are, like not really interested in politics, because I guess they don't think it's something for them, because they think, oh, Danielle, you're just, like, you're just different, like, you're not, they're like, oh, you're just, like, interested in politics, you're like, I don't know how to say, like, because most of my friends are not, like, most of them are, like, from other countries. They're, like, immigrants like myself. So they just think, oh, like, you're just a bit different from us. So, like, you can be our own friend that tells us what to do, which I don't think it's right. I think everyone has a voice in politics. And I think even if I'm not on the podium, being, like, vocal about it, I'm like, yeah, you can do X, Y, and Z, or and not shaming people for not knowing. I think that is awfully important.
Other people as people anymore, and we potentially don't see, if people hiding behind online accounts don't think they're really saying that, I don't think they also appreciate that there's a person behind the other online account. But it scares me. I don't think it's a social media problem. It scares me that this is what people have always thought, but they've had to keep it inside. I think the fact that social media has become more prevalent is just showing us the extent of the problem that misogyny has always been. We can see it better now. We have a visual for it.
Yeah. I think that women in the workplace have a level playing field, and I'll just go along like that.
Hi everybody, it's lovely to be here. As Alana's just said, I'm Chief Executive of Young Women's Trust, and we champion young women in the workplace, particularly young women on lower incomes. And we focus on England and Wales, but we're a sister organisation to... Yeah, can you hear me okay, everybody? Yeah. A sister organisation to the Young Women's Movement in Scotland, so it's fab to be with you. We've done research with... young women and young men in England and Wales, and we found that 50% of young women have experienced discrimination in the workplace. So the short answer to your question about whether there's a level playing field for me would be no. And we also surveyed managers in companies, and we found that a third of them confirmed that they thought there was sexist behaviour in their workplace. And shockingly, 15% thought that men were more suited to senior management jobs than women, which is a kind of sort of sexist attitude that you thought might have died with the dinosaurs. But they're still alive and well, at least from this evidence from England and Wales. And that discrimination in the workplace is means that alongside the sort of sectors that young women are working with and the unpaid care they're doing outside of work, means they're taking home across the UK 1/5 less than young men per year, about £4,000 per year less. And that income inequality grows through the course of their lives, which I know there's a lot of young women in the audience here. There is going to be some good news in this session today, but that grows to a big pensions gap when women are older in their later life. So getting equality right in the workplace is absolutely, absolutely key, and we haven't got it yet.
Hi everyone, I'm Jack Anderson and I'm the MSYP for Dundee City East. Totally agree with you on that question, Claire, about the being a level playing field, and some of the statistics you've just shared are completely shocking. It just feels like they're historic, but still alive and well. In anticipation of coming along here today, I've spoken to friends, family and colleagues about their experience, and I'm in no doubt there isn't a level playing field for women in the workplace. Whether it's a particular industry still being dominated by men finding it easier to progress into management or leadership positions, or the gender pay gap that's still in place. I think that just shows the broad range of inequality that still exists.
I agree with you, there definitely does need to be a culture shift within the workplace, 100%. Jack, do you want to go on?
Yeah. So I think looking at it from the point of view of someone who's just left school, and my peers and friends are in a similar position, I think something that really affects young people is a lack of positive role models, particularly in industries and sectors that are dominated by men. So I know, speaking to friends, they'll talk about, I had one who did work experience this summer, and she'd come out of it saying, oh, I wouldn't want to work for that company in the senior leadership positions. It was just men, and it completely put her off. And I think that's an experience, and it's off-putting for young women and girls entering the industry, seeing that, and it is putting them off. So I think we do need to absolutely do more to encourage and promote these positive role models to young people in schools, so that they are able to see it and see a route for them in that industry, particularly things like construction, manufacturing, law. that are typically dominated by men. We do need to show that there are women in these industries and sectors, and you can make a good and enjoyable career out of it. And I think it's a similar thing as well for other minorities as well, whether it's LGBT or BAME. It's a similar thing in these industries where they don't feel represented, they can't see themselves in the workforce, and it does put them off entering it, particularly at our level where we are thinking about university, college,
of course, definitely.
Apprenticeships. It is, when you're looking at all the options, it can be really off-putting.
Yeah.
So use your power for good as a line manager. Champion the people that you're working with. Listen to what their needs are. And we're in the Young Women's Trust doing training for line managers about what's it like to be a young woman in the workplace, and how do you be that change. So and also, there's a lot of male allies. It's fantastic to be on the panel with you, Jack. Sometimes I speak in all women groups with all women panel members. But there are men out there who are saying in meetings, oh, I think the young woman over there, Alana, has just made that point. Thank you for making it again. But she's just, she said that. Or, oh, I think you'll find that Carrie was speaking there and you've just interrupted her. Carrie, would you like to carry on with what you were saying? You know, ways of making sure that for some organisations and cultures where men have got used to being able to speak their views. Apparently, there's just some research done that I was reading last night saying 25% of conversations in the workplace and meetings, women are speaking 25% of the time when they are in groups where they're predominantly male. And the more you get women in the workplace, the more women feel able to talk and bring their whole selves to work.
Yeah. Jack?
Yeah, I think kind of building on what you'd said, the lack of positive leadership, I definitely think is a big one. When I was doing some reading ahead of coming in today, I was really shocked to see that I think in 2022, there was only 9 women CEOs in the FTSE 100 companies and only 12 in the FTSE 250 companies, which just seems absolutely incredible in this day and age. And I think it shows that if you've got men in these positions, they're not really understanding the issues that women have. So if you've not got that mix of leadership at the top of the company, it's not going to come down. So that to me, I think, is a really big problem. And I think it said on the current trajectory, it'll be 2045 until we've got equality in the boardroom, which just seems absolutely crazy and definitely something that we need to work on to ensure that we're getting equality at the high levels of our businesses as well. But I think you touched on it, Alana, that in the Scottish Youth Parliament a few years ago, we had a male chair and vice chair, and now that we've just elected our all-female board. And in the we've got a young women's empowerment group, and that met in August, and the members of that had picked up on the difference it's made within the organisation to feel a woman leading it, and that their issues were being reflected and represented. So it is making a big difference just within our organisation alone.